Hello, myself Dr. Frank Shikan. I'll be talking about the fractures and dislocations. So a fracture is a break or bend in the continuity of the bone, and this specifically means the cortex of the bone. The classification is based on the etiology, like how the fracture is caused. The relationship of the fracture with the external environment divides into open fracture and the closed fracture, and the displacement of the fracture and the pattern of the fracture. The factors usually cited in evaluating the failure of the bone are the type, magnitude, and the rate of load, and the material and structural properties of the bone. Bone is an anisotropic material in that it exhibits different stress-strain relationships depending on the direction in which the stress is applied. Cancellous and cortical bones also differ because of the porosity and diameter of their respective cross-sections. Cortical bone fractures in vitro when strain exceeds 2% of the original length, whereas cancellous bone does not fail until the strain exceeds 7%. In analyzing fracture patterns, the mode of the loading offers insight into the mechanism of the injury and possible associated injuries. Loads usually are described as tension, compression, bending, shear torsion, or a combination of these. The mode of bone failure can predict the soft tissue injury and stability of the fracture. Here you can see the different types of forces which are acting on the bone, which will lead to fracture pattern. So first one which you can see is the unloaded bone. One which you can see, the second one, is the distraction force. The next one is the compression force on the fracture side. The other one is the bending force, a shear force, a torsional force, and a combination of all. So trauma principle. The patients with multiple injuries have fractures or dislocations of both, and the orthopedic surgeon plays a pivotal role in the trauma team. An example is placement of a pelvic binder in a patient with an open book pelvic injury who remains hematodynamically stable, unstable despite aggressive initial fluid and blood replacement. Open fractures, pelvic or acetabular injuries with associated genitourinary injuries, and extremity fractures with vascular injuries are other examples of situations in which communication and coordination among the various team members are essential. Damage control orthopedics, DCO, is the form of rapid immobilization of fractures with external fixation to obtain stability and recover length, while allowing full evaluation of the extremity, is now the standard care. Operative treatment should not be undertaken if hemodynamic stabilization is not obtained, if potentially life-threatening conditions have not been resolved, or if laboratory or radiographic evaluations are inadequate for formulation of a satisfactory surgical plan. Orthopedic damage control measures can be undertaken in the emergency department or resuscitation area in special circumstances. Emergent external fixation of long bone is unstable patient may be necessary, but can be complicated by pin site infections or less frequently deep vein thrombosis. Radiograph should be made to show the extent of the type of injury to the bone. The extent of the soft tissue damage sometimes cannot be determined until surgical exploration. The time since injury and the type of extent of soft tissue damage have a direct bearing on the choice of the treatment. On the basis of the etiology, the fracture can be divided into traumatic fracture, which is a fracture sustained due to trauma, is called a traumatic fracture. Normal bone can withstand considerable force and breaks only when subjected to excessive force. Most fractures seen in day-to-day practice falls into this category. Example, the fractures caused by a fall, road traffic accident, a fight, etc. A pathological fracture is a fracture through a bone which has been made weak by some underlying disease, is called a pathological fracture. A trivial or no force may be required to cause such a fracture. Here the bone is weakened and it can break anytime. So example, a fracture to the bone weakened by metastasis. Although traumatic fractures have a predictable and generally successful outcome, pathological fractures often go into non-union. Here you can see a weakened bone due to some metabolic disorder, and you can see a stress or a pathological fracture in the weakened area of the bone. Stress fracture, this is a special type of fracture sustained due to chronic repetitive injury, that is stress causing a break in bony trabeculum. These often present as only pain and may not be visible on the x-rays. On the basis of displacement, the fractures are classified as undisplaced fractures. These fractures are easy to be identified by the absence of the significant displacement. Displaced fractures, the factor responsible for displacement, are the fracturing force and the muscle pull on the fracture fragments, also called as deforming forces. The third is the gravity. While describing the displacement of a fracture, conventionally it is the displacement of the distal fragment in relation to the proximal fragment, which is mentioned. The displacement can be in the form of shift angulation or rotation. Here you can see the shear force, where you can see the shifting of the bone, the angulation, and the rotation. On the basis of the relationship with the external environment, the fracture can be divided into closed fracture and the open fracture. Closed fracture, a fracture not communicating with the external environment, that is the overlying skin or the other soft tissues are intact, is called a closed fracture. A An open fracture is a fracture with break in the overlying skin and the soft tissues, leading to the fracture communicating with the external environment is called an open fracture. A fracture may be open within or outside, so called internally or externally open fractures. Internally open from within, the sharp fracture end pierces the skin from within, resulting in an open fracture. Externally open fracture, open from outside, the object causing the fracture lacerates the skin and soft tissue over the bone as it breaks into the bone, resulting in an open fracture. Exposure of the open fracture to the external environment makes it prone to infection. This is risk is more in externally open fractures. Now there are certain classifications for the open fracture. One is the Castillo-Anderson's classification, where the type 1 open fractures have clean wound less than 1 cm long. In type 2 wound, the laceration is more than 1 cm long, but it is without extensive soft tissue damage, skin flaps or avulsions. In type 3A open fractures have extensive soft tissue lacerations or flap, but maintain adequate soft tissue coverage of bone. All the result from high energy trauma regardless of the size of the wound. This group includes segmental or severely comminuted fractures, even those with 1 cm laceration. Type 3B open fractures have extensively soft tissue loss with the periosteal stripping and bone exposure. They usually are massively contaminated. Type 3 open fractures include open fractures with an arterial injury that requires repair regardless of the size of the soft tissue wound. Here you can see the soft tissue grading system for the injury. Here you can see a clinical picture showing an open fracture where the fracture itself or the fracture hematoma is in contact or is communicating with the external environment. Here you can see the bone spiking out of the wound area. Here you can see another fracture, an open injury, which is later fixed by a intramedullary interlocking device. On the basis of the complexity of the treatment, it is divided into simple fracture and complex fracture. Simple fracture is a fracture in two pieces, usually easy to treat, is called a simple fracture. Example, transverse fracture of the humerus. Complex fracture is a fracture in multiple pieces, usually difficult to treat, is called a complex fracture, a comminuted fracture of the tibia. On basis of the quantum of the force causing the fracture, it can be a high velocity injury, it can be a low velocity injury. So high velocity injury, there are fractures sustained as a result of the severe trauma of course, as in traffic accidents. In these fractures, there is severe soft tissue injury and periosteal muscle injury. There is extensive devascularization of the fracture end. Such fractures are often unstable and slow to heal. The high velocity injury, road traffic accident causing a fracture in the middle one third of the leg. Here you can see a high velocity gunshot injury, and you can see the pellets of the wound. Low velocity injury, these are fractures are sustained as a result of mild trauma poses as it fall. There's little associated soft tissue injury and hence these fractures often heal predictably. Lately, there's a change in pattern of the fractures due to shift from low velocity to high velocity injuries. More complex fractures which are difficult to treat. Again, a gunshot injury with the pellets. See? On the basis of the pattern, the transverse fracture, this fracture, the fracture line is perpendicular to the long axis of the bone. Such fracture is caused by a tapping or a bending force. Here you can see the transverse, oblique, spiral, comminuted, and segmental fractures. Oblique fracture is the fracture, is the fracture line is oblique. Such fracture is caused by bending force, which adhesion as a component along the long axis of the bone. A spiral fracture, in this fracture, the fracture line runs spirally in more than one plane. Such a fracture is caused by primarily distinct force. Comminuted fractures, there's a fracture with multiple fragments. It is caused by crushing or compression force along the long axis of the bone. A segmental fracture, in this type, there are two fractures in one bone but at different levels. A fracture may have a combination of two or more patterns. For example, it may be a comminuted but primarily a transverse fracture. Here you can see the various types of fractures. Fracture with eponyms. A Montagia fracture dislocation is a fracture of the proximal third of the ulna with dislocation of the head of the radius. A Galesi fracture dislocation is a fracture of the distal third of the radius with dislocation of the distal radio-ulna joint. Knife stick prick or defense fracture is an isolated fracture of the shaft of the ulna sustained while trying to ward off a stick blow. A Pollis fracture is a fracture occurring in adults at the corticocancellous junction, which is 2 cm proximal to the joint line of the distal end of the radius with dorsal tilt and other displacements. A Smith fracture is the reverse of the Pollis, a fracture occurring in adults at the corticocancellous junction of the distal end of the radius with ventral tilt instead of the dorsal and other displacement, that is reverse Pollis. A Barton's fracture is a marginal fracture, intra-articular fracture through the distal articular surface of the radius, taking a margin anterior or posterior of the distal radius, with the carpal displaced anteriorly or posteriorly. A Schoffer's fracture is an intra-articular fracture, oblique fracture of the styloid process of the distal. distal radius. A Bennett's fracture dislocation is an oblique intra-articular fracture at the base of the first metacarpal with subluxation of the trapezio metacarpal joint. A Boxer's fracture is a ventrally displaced fracture through the neck of the fifth metacarpal, usually occurs in Boxer's. Side sweep fractures. It's an elbow injury sustained when one elbow projecting out of the car is side swept by another vehicle. Combination of the fracture of the distal end of the humerus with fractures of the proximal end of the radius or the ulna. A bumper fracture is a comminuted depressed fracture of the lateral condyle of the tibia, most commonly seen in the road traffic accidents. Quartz fracture is a bimodular ankle fracture. A Cotton's fracture is a trimalleolar ankle fracture, which involves the lateral, medial, as well as the posterior malleolus. Mesenius fracture is a typical ankle fracture where there is a fracture of the neck of the fibula as well. A pylon fracture is a comminuted intra-articular fracture of the distal end of the tibia. An aviator's fracture is a fracture of the neck of the talus seen in the pylons. Jones fracture is an avulsion fracture of the base of the fifth metatarsal. A Rolando fracture is a fracture of the base of the first metacarpal and it's an extra-articular fracture. A Jefferson's fracture, fractures of the first cervical vertebra. A Hangman's fracture is through the pedicle of the lamina of C2 vertebra with subluxates of C2 over C3, sustained in hands. A whiplash injury is a cervical spine injury where sudden flexion followed by hyperextension takes place. A Chance fracture, also called as seatbelt fracture, the fracture line runs horizontally through the body of the vertebra through and through to the posterior ligaments. A burst fracture is a comminuted fracture of the vertebral body where the fragment burst out in different directions. Clay Shovler's fracture is an avulsion fracture of the spinous process of one or more of the lower cervical and upper thoracic vertebrae. March fracture is the fatigue fracture or the stress fracture or the shaft or the second and third metatarsal. Dashboard fracture, a fracture of the posterior lip of the acetabulum often associated with posterior dislocation of the hip. A straddle fracture, bilateral superior and inferior pubic ramus fracture. Malignant fracture is a type of pelvis fracture where there is a combination of fracture pubic rami anteriorly and sacroiliac joint or ilium posteriorly or on the same side. Mallet finger is a finger flex at the DIP joint due to avulsion rupture of the extensor tendon at the base of the distal phalanx. Signs and symptoms of the fracture are the pain and tenderness, bone protruding in open fractures, a visible deformity, swelling or bruising in the localized area, loss of function or also called as loss of transmission of movement, numbness and tingling if there is a nerve compression which is involved, and diminished distal vascularity, diminished or absent pulsation, ischemia or ganglia, and also the crepitus which is felt at the bony ends. The assessment is done in the field that first aid principles of ABC of the ATLS protocol. Stabilize the patient, check for deformity, tenderness and painful area, circulation, splint and transport. Injury history, general history is a must. Examination, look, feel, move. The patient moves first when you move. Inspect the entire region, move the other joints to see the associated injuries. X-rays, which are supposed to be taken, the approach is read the whole film, confirm the patient part, side, the rule of two, that is a joint above and below, two views, two times before and after the intervention. Describing the fractures, what bone, what part of the bone, ulna, the diaphysis, fracture geometry, or is it a pattern of the fracture. If it's a displaced fracture, check for the length, angulation, look for the apex of the two longitudinal lines, and displacement, see the translation, rotation, you can see clinically. Treatment of soft tissue injury, initial treatment of open wound before the transport of a medical facility should include pressure over the wound, splinting of fractures, and placement of the sterile dressings. Rapid transport to appropriate medical center is essential because further bacterial contamination can occur with exposure of the tissue to air. In the emergency department, rapid evaluation of the patient's condition and immediate debridement and irrigation of the wound are essential. The following steps are recommended for open injuries. Treat the open fracture as emergencies. Perform through the initial evaluation to diagnose life and limb-threatening injuries. Begin appropriate antibiotic therapy in the emergency department or at the latest in the operating room and continue treatment for 2-3 days only. Immediately debride the wound of the contaminated and devitalized tissue. Copiously irrigate and perform repeat debridement within 24 to 72 hours. Stabilize the fracture with the method determined initial evaluation. Leave the wound open. This is a controversial topic. Some people try to use the vacuum assisted therapy here. People early perform early autogenous cancerous bone grafting. That is the Papineau technique for closure. Rehabilitate the involved extremity aggressively. Morrell-Levy syndrome, which occurs when the skin is separated from the fascia, creating a pocket under which considerable bleeding can occur. this is internal declogging. This is a subcutaneous hematoma, but the hematoma can become so large that it seriously threatens the viability of the skin superficial tree. Occurs frequently in patients with pelvic fractures, especially in obese individuals in whom there was a shear component to the injury. MRI and ultrasonography have been recommended to confirm the diagnosis. Multiple treatment options have been suggested for including radical incision, which frequently leaves a massive wound, and less invasive methods such as wound drainage. The primary recommendation is to treat the soft tissue problem at the same time the fracture is stabilized. Here you can see the Morrell Lemelli lesion or internal degloving of the. We prefer to wait and watch initially rather to proceed with immediate decompression because of the risk of devascularizing additional skin by opening the wound. We have some experience with percutaneous aspiration, but we have noted recurrence of the swelling. The thigh is especially at risk because of the erratic course of its blood supply. The lesion should be treated at the time of internal fixation. Draining the hematoma with small incision followed by application of a compression bandage has been recommended. We have used a similar drainage technique, but we have noted an increased incidence of infection when the skin necrosis or wound breakage occurs. Here you can again see the Morrell Lemelli lesion which has been opened up. Pain control in fractures. The pharmacological is the systemic analgesia, which is morphine and NSAIDs. Nerve block, neuroaxial anesthesia, spinal cord epidural anesthesia can also provide a pain relief. Non-pharmacological methods of treatment are transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, also called as stents, a stabilization of the fracture using the traction. The general aim of the early fracture management is to control hemorrhage, provide pain relief, prevent ischemia, pre-perfusion injury, and remove potential sources of contamination. The three R's of the treatment are reduce, retain, and rehabilitate. Reduction, a close reduction, pull the distal portion of the limb, give a traction and a counter traction. Reposition, reverse the original forces, and alignment is restored in every plane. In open reduction, the fragments are visualized, forces of injury which have been caused displacement in every direction are reversed. Interestingly enough, we observe in a fresh fracture, the serrated ends of the fragments are matched and compressed and held in position by assisted and the internal fixation is carrying out. In open reduction, when the closed reduction is failed, the indications are when the closed reduction failed, a displaced intra-articular fracture, an avulsion fracture, when an operation needed for associated injury or polytrauma, pathological fractures, arterial damage and nerve injuries, and open fractures. The retain is the aim to split the fracture in an immobilized position. Rehabilitate is more correctly restore the functions to prevent the stiffness, not only the injured part, but also the patient as a whole. The objectives are to reduce the edema, preserve the joint movement, restore muscle power, and guide patient to normal activity. Open fracture, the aim is to try to prevent them from becoming infected. The four essentials are antibiotic prophylaxis, the debridement, that is removal of the dead and devitalized tissues layer by layer, the stabilization of the fracture, and early definitive wound care. General indication for surgical reduction and stabilization. Rather than listing the absolute indication for surgical reduction and stabilization, those situations are described in which the probability is high surgical treatment will be required to obtain the optimal result. Displaced intra-articular fractures suitable for surgical reduction and stabilization. Unstable fractures in which an appropriate trial of conservative management has failed. Major avulsion fractures associated with disruption of important muscular tendinous unit. All ligamentous groups that have been shown to have poor results with conservative treatment. Displaced pathological fractures in patient not intermittently terminal. Fractures of which conservative treatment is known to yield poor functional results, such as femoral neck fractures, Galenic fracture dislocation, and Montpellier fracture dislocation. Displaced physeal injuries that have a propensity for growth arrest, that is Salter Heist type 3 and 4. Fractures with compartment syndrome that require fasciotomies. Non-union, especially malreduced ones in which the previous conservative surgical treatments have failed. The contraindications to surgical reductions are osteoporotic bone that is too fragile to allow stabilization of internal fixation, soft tissue overlying the fracture or planned surgical approach for poor quality because of the scarring burns, active infection or dermatitis, that internal fixation would result in loss of soft tissue coverage or exacerbation of the infection, active infection or osteomyelitis, fracture comminution to a degree that does not allow successful reconstruction. General medical conditions are that are contraindications to the anesthesia. Undisplaced stable impacted fractures in acceptable position do not require surgical exploration or reduction. Inadequate equipment, manpowering and training and experience.